up by a tornado warning on my phone, and I'm deathly, deathly afraid of tornadoes. I've never been involved in one, but I've always been afraid of them. So I've been awake since like 2 o'clock. So I start thinking, what can I do? So I decided to make a video for you guys. Now, I know in my last video, I was reading The Stranger Beside Me, but I've been reading it, and there's just no way that I'm going to be able to read any true crime books to you guys, because they're all pretty graphic and very descriptive about the crimes committed, and I just don't feel comfortable reading that kind of content on my channel. But for the people that enjoyed my reading video, I do have another book, and this one, I promise you guys, is going to stick, hopefully. Sophie Kinsella is one of my favorite authors ever. She is the author of Confessions of a Shopaholic series, but she's also the author of another book called Remember Me. And now I think I've actually mentioned that book in my favorite books videos, and I love that book, so I definitely recommend it. I am still growing out my nails. It just seems like they've grown to a certain point and then they've stopped. But I'm proud of myself. I've gone about 2 weeks without chewing my nails. So let's see if we can't make any tapping noises yet. But yeah, see. But this is also, as before, everyone that has subscribed to my channel. Thank you for the lovely comments. And if you are a newcomer to my channel, hi, Shopaholic ties a knot. Can you keep a secret? Shopaholic and sister. The undomestic goddess. Shopaholic and baby. Remember me. 20s girl. Mini shopaholic. I've got your number. Wedding night. Shopaholic to the stars. Finding Audrey, which was another good one. Shopaholic to the rescue. My not so perfect life. Surprise me, and I owe you one. Little computer there with a cup of coffee. That sounds nice right now. To my friend and editor, Joy Trickler. My stomach is growling. Covered with a brown I suddenly catch sight of an old man in a mac in the kitchen section. He's reaching with a shaking hand for a plain white mug, and I hurry over to get it for him. "Here you are," I say with a friendly smile. "I can take that to the till for you. Do you need any more mugs, or can I help you with anything else?" "No, thank you, love," he says in a quavering voice. "I only need the one mug." "Is white your favorite color?" I gently press, because there's something so poignant about buying one plain white mug that I can't bear it. "Well," his gaze roams doubtfully over the display, "I do like a brown mug. This one, maybe." I retrieve a brown earthenware mug that he probably discounted because it was too far out of his reach. It's solid with a nice big handle. It looks like a cozy fireside mug. The man's eyes light up, and I think I knew it. When your life is restricted, something like a mug choice becomes huge. "It's a pound more expensive," I tell him. "It's $4.99. Is that okay?" Because you never take anything for granted. You never assume. Dad taught me that. "That's fine, love," he smiles back. "That's fine. Great. We'll come this way." I lead him carefully down the narrow aisle, keeping my eyes fixed on danger points, which isn't quite the selfless gesture it might seem. This man is a knocker-overer. You can tell as soon as you lay eyes on him. Trembling hands, uncertain gaze, shabby old trolley that he's pulling behind him, all the signs of a classic knocker-overer. And the last thing I need is a floor full of smash crockery, not with Jake's visitors arriving any moment. I smile brightly at the man hiding my innermost thoughts, although the very word Jake passing through my brain has made my stomach clench with nerves. It always happens. I think Jake and my stomach clenches. I'm used to it by now, although I don't know if it's normal. I don't know how other people feel about their siblings. My best friend Hannah hasn't got any. It's not the kind of question you ask random people, is it? "How do your siblings make you feel?" Kind of gnawed up and anxious and wary. Because that's definitely how my brother Jake makes me feel. Nicole doesn't make me feel anxious, but she does make me feel gnawed up. And quite often, like hitting something. To sum up, neither of them makes me feel good. Maybe it's because both of them are older than me and were tough acts to follow. When I started at secondary school, aged 11, Jake was 16 and the star of the football team. Nicole was 15, stunningly beautiful, and had been scouted as a model. Everyone in the school wanted to be her friend. People would say to me in awed tones, "Is Jake Farr your brother? Is Nicole Farr your sister?" Nicole was as drifty and vague then as she is now. But Jake dominated everything. He was focused, bright-eyed, quick to anger. I'll always remember the time he got in a row with Mom and went and kicked a can around the street, outside shouting swear words into the night sky. I watched him from an upstairs window, gripped in a bit Is there other reasons for me to feel rubbish around Jake? Tangible reasons, financial reasons, which I will not think about now. Instead, I smile at the old man, trying to make him feel that I have all the time in the world, like Dad would have done. Marag rings up the price, and the man gets out an old leather coin purse. 50, I hear him saying as he peers at a coin. Is that a 50 pence piece? Let's have a look, love, says Marag in her reassuring way. Marag's been with us for 7 years. She was a customer first and applied when she saw an ad pinned up on a notice board. Now she's assistant manager and does all the buying for greeting cards. She has a brilliant eye. No, that's a 10 pence, she says kindly to the old man. Have you got another pound coin in there? My eyes wibble up to the Coke can and stained chessboard again. It doesn't matter, I tell myself. There isn't time to sort now. And the visitors won't notice it. They are coming to show us their range of olive oils. Not inspect the place, just ignore it. Fixing, ignore it. Oh God, but I can't. It's driving me nuts. My eye keeps flickering upward to it. My fingers are doing that thing they do whenever I'm desperate to fix something, when some situation or other is driving me mad. They drum each other feverishly, and my feet do a weird stepping motion, forward, across, back, forward, across, back. I've been like this since I was a little kid. It's bigger than me. I know it would be mad to drag a ladder out, get a bucket and water, and clean the stain up when the visitors might arrive at any moment. I know this. Greg, as he appears from behind the glassware section, my voice shoots out before I can stop it. Quick, get a step ladder. I need to clean up that stain. Greg looks up to where I'm pointing and gives a guilty jump as he sees the Coke can. That wasn't me, he says at once. It definitely wasn't me. Then he pauses before adding, I mean, if it was, I didn't notice. The thing about Greg is he's very loyal to the shop, and he works really long hours, so I forgave him quite a lot. Doesn't matter who it was, I say briskly. Let's just get rid of it. Okay, Greg says, as though digesting this. Yeah, but aren't those people about to arrive? Yes, which is why we need to be quick. We need to hurry. Okay, says Greg again, not moving a muscle. Yeah, got you. Where's Jake? This is a very good question. Jake is the one who met these olive oil people in the first place. In a bar, apparently. He's the one who set up this meeting, and here he isn't. But family loyalty keeps me from saying any of this aloud. Family loyalty is a big thing in my life. Maybe the biggest thing. Some people hear the Lord Jesus guiding them. I hear my dad, before he died, saying in his East End accent, family is it, Fixie. Family is what drives us. Family is everything. Family loyalty is basically our religion. He's always landing you in it, Jake is, Greg mutters. You never know when he's going to turn up. Can't rely on him. We're short-staffed today, too. What with your mom taking the day off? All of this might be true, but I can hear Dad's voice in my head again. as far as work in the shop, Mom, me, Jake, and Nicole. But only Mom and I are full-time. Jake calls himself our consultant. He has another business of his own, and he's doing an MBA online, and he pops in when he can. And Nicole is doing a yoga instructor course Monday to Friday, so she can only come in at weekends, which she does sometimes. I expect he's on his way, I add briskly. Anyway, we've just got to deal with it. Come on, ladder. As Jake drags a step ladder across the shop floor, I hurry to our back room and run some hot water into a bucket. I just need to dash up the ladder, wipe the stain away, grab the can, jump down, and clear up everything before the visitors arrive. Easy. The leisure section is a bit incongruous, surrounded as it is by tea towels and jam-making kits, but it was Dad who set it up that way, so we've never changed it. Dad loved a good board game. He always said board games are as essential to a household as spoons. Customers would come in for Kettle and leave with Monopoly too. And ever since he died nine years ago, we've tried to keep the shop just as he created it. We still sell licorice. All sorts. We still have a tiny hardware section, and we still stock the leisure section with games, balls, and water guns. The thing about Dad was he could sell anything to anyone. He was a charmer, but not a flashy, dishonest charmer. A genuine charmer. He believed in every product he sold. He wanted to make people happy. He did make people happy. He created a community in this little corner of West London. He called himself an immigrant, being East End born. And it's still going. Even if the customers who really knew Dad are fewer every year. Okay, I say, hurrying out to the shop floor with the bucket. This won't take a sec. I dash up the steps of the ladder and start scrubbing at the brown stain. I can see Marag below me, demonstrating a paring knife to a customer, and I resist the urge to join in the conversation. I know about knives. I've done chef training, but you can't be everywhere at once, and... They're here, announces Greg. There's a car pulling into the parking space. It was Greg who insisted if we were serve our only parking spot for these all of all people. They'll have asked, do you have parking? And he won't have one to say only one space, because he's pretentious that way. So we'll have said airily, of course, as though we've got an underground vault. No problem, I say breathlessly. I'm done, all good. I dump the cloth and the Coke can into the bucket and swiftly start descending. There, that took no time, and now it won't bug me, and careful on that ladder. I hear Greg's voice below, but he's always regaling us with stupid health and safety rules he's read online, so I don't alter my step or my pace until he shouts stop, sounding gently alarmed. Fixie, Stacy yells from the till. She's another of our sales assistants, and you can't miss her piercing nasal voice. Look out. As my head whips around, it takes me a moment to comprehend what I've done. I've snagged my sleeve on a netball hoop, which is caught on the handle of a massive tub of bouncy balls, and now it's tipping off the shelf. There's nothing I can do to stop it. Shit. Oh my god. I lift my spare hand to protect my have so many other bloody things anyway. As I reach the bottom of the ladder, I look around in hot horror. It's a miracle that nothing's been smashed. Even so, the floor is a carpet of bouncy balls. Quick, I instruct Greg and Stacy, teamwork. Pick them up. I'll go and head off the visitors. As I hurry toward the door, Greg and Stacy don't look anything like a team. In fact, they look like an anti-team. They keep bumping into each other and cursing. Greg is hastily stuffing balls down his shirt front and in his trouser pockets, and I yell, "Put them back in the tub." I didn't even notice that coke stain, volunteer Stacy, as I pass with one of her shrugs. "You should have left it." Is that really helpful? I want to retort, but I don't. For a start, Stacy's a good worker and worth keeping on side. You just have to deal with what Mom and I call the Sims, Stacy's inappropriate moments. But of course, the real reason I say nothing is that she's right. I should have left it. I just can't